Good morning. Welcome to worship this morning at Union Chapel Indy. If you're here in person, thank you for making your way in. If you're joining us online, thank you for being a part of this time together. I'm Pastor Elizabeth Gilbert. So glad to worship with all of you this morning. If you're in person, on the way in, you had an opportunity to pick up a little card, looks like this. I invite you to do that every time you're here. Complete it, drop it in the offering box, and we can stay connected that way then in ministry and mission and prayer together. If you're with us online, invite you to leave us a comment, whether you're joining us on Facebook or YouTube, let us know you're with us. You can also reach out to us at hello@unionchapelindy.org. We'd love to hear from you, pray with you, connect with you in that way. Today, we conclude our series at the table, and we will do that at the table, celebrating the sacrament of Holy Communion. In the Methodist tradition, everyone here is welcome to participate. If you're worshiping with us online, you are welcome to participate. If you're online with us, I invite you to take a moment sometime in the first part of this worship experience. Gather a piece of bread, some crackers, something along those lines, some juice or water. Have those at the ready, and then you can come to the table with us as well. Again, thank you for being here. Welcome to the table.
At God's table, there's a place for you. Come be seated, eat his food, and enjoy the feast of abundance. There is no room for hunger or thirst at the table. Everyone is invited to his table, and everyone is satisfied. There is joy, there is peace, there is love, and there is fellowship. Come be seated and be filled.
Music this morning will come to us via the miracle of technology. I invite you to engage the music this morning in whatever way is meaningful for you. Welcome.
I searched the world. Are never enough.
Any kids that want to come spend a minute with me? Hi, guys. How's everybody today?
Good.
Good. Have a seat. Come on up.
Doing
what?
Are we still doing
a
regular thing?
Like you do with Miss Leanne?
Yeah.
Yeah, sorry. No, Miss Leanne's a little under the weather today.
I have something to tell you.
Yes?
I'm almost in the next rank in school, in swim school, glide a free.
Awesome. Congratulations. You're doing good in school, aren't you?
Swim school.
Awesome.
Yeah, my boyfriend got a ribbon today.
Very good. So you've been swimming already today? That's awesome. Well, hey, I got a question for you guys. What's your most favorite food in the whole wide world?
Dinosaur chicken nuggets. Garlic-soaked cookies.
What kind of cookies?
Garlic-soaked cookies.
Wow, those sound amazing. What's your favorite food, Gavin?
I don't know.
Don't know? If you could have anything for supper, what would it be? Ice cream? Yeah. I think that's a great choice for supper. What do y'all think, huh? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah? What else?
Iceberg.
An iceberg. Wow, that would be something. That would be something. My favorite food might be donuts.
Ew.
You don't like donuts?
I just had a donut.
I love donuts. Oh, well, they're not very good for you. That's for sure. How do you think you would feel if all you ever ate was your favorite food?
Bored.
Bored? Oh, yeah, bored.
Happy?
Happy? Huh? For a while, maybe? I'd have a tummy ache if all I ever ate was donuts. And pretty soon I'd look kind of like a donut, wouldn't I? Yeah. Yeah, I would. So sometimes there are foods we like and we can enjoy them, but we can't eat them all the time. That would not be healthy. There is one meal, though, well, even that all the time, if that's all you ate, wouldn't be healthy. There's one meal, though, we can eat all the time, and it's good for us. Any guesses what that is? What's that? A guess? Could it be the bread and juice of Holy Communion? Huh? Sometimes when you...
The bread of life.
Do you know what? That's exactly right, the bread of life. And who is the bread of life?
God.
Yeah, Jesus. We're going to talk about that today. Yep. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. And whenever you come to the table with me, you'll be full and you will have everything you need. So that's what we're going to talk about today. I've got a couple coloring pages for you to take. This one says, taste and see that the Lord is good. We're going to talk about coming to the table with Jesus and it being so good. Okay, so you can color that. But look at this one. What's that?
Table.
A blank table. Will you draw me a picture of your favorite meal? Huh? Okay.
Yeah.
And guess
okay.
What? But that will be called.
Are people going to be sitting at the table?
Yes. And Miss Leanne's not here today.
Peter.
Yeah. Everybody gets to sit at the table. Yep.
So Peter, John.
Judas even sat at Jesus' table. Yep. Judas. Everybody gets to sit at Jesus' table.
Listen
to me. Yeah, yeah, Jesus loves everybody.
Don't forget Goliath,
yeah.
Goliath did.
Okay, guys, Miss Leanne is not here today, so you're going to take your markers and your papers back to your grown-ups and spend some time with those, and then later you're going to be invited to come to the table, okay? And the grown-ups can help you do that, all right? Let's say a prayer before we continue. Holy God, thank you for the foods we get to enjoy and the food that is healthy and for the food that sustains us, which is your son, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thanks, you guys. You can go back to your grown-ups now. Nope, you're going
to
sit with Papa. You got your papers? Okay. Very good, guys. Very good. Well, as we continue in our worship. Our final story about Jesus at the table today, we find in the Gospel of John. John chapter 6. Invite you to open that if you want to follow along. And before we actually get to today's few verses, I want to set the stage a little bit. So early in chapter 6 of the Gospel of John, We read about this miracle, and this is the one miracle that's in all of the gospel stories. The only miracle that's in all four of the gospel stories. And it is the feeding of the 5,000, where Jesus takes just a few loaves of bread, a couple fish, and feeds thousands. So he performs this miracle, feeds the crowd, and then later that day goes across the lake. That was a big day. He's taking a break. He goes across the lake. But the crowd comes looking for him the next day, right? They had this miraculous meal the day before. They go looking for him the next day. They want the same thing again, right? Jesus, feed us again. And Jesus has this conversation with them and says, you know, I gave you miraculous food, it filled your belly. Your ancestors had manna, miraculous bread in the wilderness, it filled their belly. I come to fill you with something else. And he says to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. But I said to you that you have seen me, and yet you do not believe. Everything that the Father gives me will come to you, and anyone who comes to me, I will never drive away. And he goes on and he talks with them about this idea that he is all they need. And then we get to today's reading in verse 48, chapter 6, 48. He says again, Jesus says, I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness and they died. But this is the bread that comes down from heaven. I imagine Jesus standing there and he touches himself. He says, this, me, I am the bread that comes down from heaven so that one may eat of it and never die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever. And the bread that I give will be for the life of the world. It's God's word for us today. Amen. I invite you to prepare your hearts to receive the word this morning and come to the table as we experience this song.
I will feast at the table of the Lord. I will feast at the table of the Lord. I won't hunger anymore at his table. I will feast at the table. come just as you are to his table.
Amen. Well, are you familiar with the phrase comfort food? Sure you are, right? Yeah. Those are those foods that do just what they say, provide particular comfort when we're stressed or we're lonely or we're away from home. They're foods that do more than just fill our stomach, right? They fill our spirit and our soul in some way. What are your go-to comfort foods? Anybody? Mashed potatoes, okay. Gravy, mashed potatoes and gravy. Dino nuggets, yep, yeah. Yes, those cookies you're talking about, absolutely. What else do you go to? Chocolate, just straight up chocolate, yeah. Ice cream, yes, yeah, Grayson. Chocolate milk, that's a good one, or hot cocoa. Yeah, that's a good one. Well, depending on what list you look at, there's a lot of comfort foods that people would identify. You'll see things on a list like apple pie, chicken noodle soup, mashed potatoes. What about grilled cheese and tomato soup? Yeah. I was actually out for lunch with a friend recently, and it was a rainy, cold day, and we both, without talking, had decided to order the tomato soup and grilled cheese, yeah. Of course, our comfort foods are connected not only to the flavors we enjoy, but to memories, especially our childhood memories, to places we associate with comfort and safety. Now, near the top of the list for me, and maybe my siblings would agree, would be Kraft macaroni and cheese. Okay, yeah. Some of us of a certain age, that was like the thing, right? And I don't know, in our home, hamburger helper, right? It was rich and creamy and warm and soupy, yep. And, you know, where we live matters. You can look at a map of regions around the United States and find different comfort foods. Here in the Midwest, one that's always at the top of the list that we haven't mentioned yet, pizza. Yeah. Some parts of the country, it's tacos or key lime pie. You can guess where that might be a favorite comfort food. Yeah, does Gavin love key lime pie? Yeah, that's good stuff. Yeah. Some places, it's barbecue, right? A good piece of meat. Well, in the church, we have our own kind of comfort food, right? The bread and cup of the sacrament of Holy Communion. We also call this the Eucharist. That's a word that means thanksgiving. Among our first experiences in nearly any church, regardless of the specific tradition or denomination, is an experience at the table. It's where we learn about Jesus' sacrifice for us, about his body and blood given for us. In the Methodist tradition, those elements are represented by bread, any variety of bread, and grape juice. Jesus himself sat at the table with his followers and said that every time we come together to break bread and drink from the cup, we are to remember him. The stories of Jesus doing this at the table the night before his death are represented in the first three Gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke in almost the same way. They read very similarly, something like this. As they were eating, Jesus took some bread, blessed it, then he broke it in pieces and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this and eat it, for this is my body." And then he took a cup of wine, gave thanks to God for it. He gave it to them and said, "Each of you drink from it, for this is my blood which confirms the covenant between God and his people. It is poured out as a sacrifice to forgive the sins of many." If you're in the church very long, that's a very common story, and we know some of those words by heart. But then we get to the Gospel of John. The Gospel of John is written much later than the other three Gospels, and we find the story of the bread and cup presented somewhat differently than in those other three Gospels. In the Gospel of John, Jesus expands the story of the table to clearly include not just the physical elements of bread and cup with which we remember Jesus, that which connects us with Jesus in some spiritual way. In John, Jesus makes clear that it is Jesus himself to whom we connect when we come to the table. In John, we don't find Jesus saying, "When you eat the bread or drink from the cup, remember me." In John, Jesus says, "I am the bread, the living bread. The bread that I give the world is my flesh." Probably better understood as, "The bread that I give the world is my own self." Subtle difference? Maybe, maybe not so subtle. Just a little farther down than we read in chapter 6, Jesus adds, verse 56, "Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them." Now, without getting hung up on the literal translation of that sentence and the images there, I think that sentence makes clear what is missing when we only remember that long ago Jesus came to a table and had this meal before his death. To come to the table where Jesus himself is present is not to simply commemorate one particular event that happened some 2,000 years ago. To come to the table is to come and be with Jesus and to share in all of Jesus' life. Participation in this meal does more than bring to mind a long-ago event. It helps create a relationship between Jesus and the person here at the table. He said, "Those who do this, those who do the table with me, abide with Jesus, and Jesus abides with them." Abide, that's a verb, that's an action word. Here, it is with Jesus, and Jesus is with us. Jesus said, "I am the living bread." Jesus invites us to do more than bring him to mind when we are here and then just go on about our lives. Jesus invites us to come here, bring our whole selves, all of our living, all of our longings, and bring all of that to the table. Bring especially those longings that can't be satisfied, can't be filled with macaroni and cheese or chocolate. When Jesus said, "I am the bread of life," he meant to give us hope that with him, we can find everything we need to be filled, to be satisfied, to be nourished, and to be loved. At Jesus' table, we find not only welcome and good company, but we find Jesus and we find life itself. In anticipation of coming to the table today, I invite you to let the images and words on the screen prepare your heart to join Jesus here. Those words, "Whenever you share in this communion, remember me. Now, while we might sometimes think of this sacrament as a bit perfunctory, as simply a ritual, these words especially remind us of what is really taking place here. Whenever you share in this communion, remember me. Communion, the word itself means sharing together. It has to do with fellowship, with relationship. When the United Methodist Church says we're in fellowship with another denomination or another tradition, that means we are in a loving relationship with them. And when we come to the communion table, we do more than eat a bite of bread and have a sip of juice and move on. We come to be in relationship with Jesus and with each other. And the word remember, interesting word, it means more than to just recall something. It also means to piece something together again, as in a memory, or maybe as in an experience. Remember, pull the members together again. When we remember Jesus at the table, we participate again with Jesus at this meal. We are one of the pieces, one of the members that come here together. With these understandings of what this is, communion, remembering, being together, being in relationship, we're going to experience the sacrament just a little different today. I want to remind you that everyone here is welcome at the table. In the Methodist tradition, everyone is welcome. You don't have to be a member here. You don't have to be a certain age. You don't have to be baptized. Children are welcome at their parents' or adults' discretion. There is bread and juice here. We use juice so that all may participate. And we have gluten-free options as well. So when you come to the table, you can just let me know if that's your preference. Now, you notice there are chairs here at the table. I'm going to invite you in a moment to come forward as you feel led. And as there is an empty chair, have a seat. Sit down for a minute. Pray. Talk with Jesus. Maybe you feel led to offer a word of encouragement or grace to someone sitting near you. Feel free to do that. I'd be happy to pray with you about something if you'll just let me know. Maybe you just want to come sit down and just be here with Jesus. Just be with Jesus. Be one of those pieces that remembers, that rebuilds, that re-experiences this meal and this table. Then when you're ready to you, when I see you do that, I will offer you the cup so that you may then take the bread, dip it in the cup, and receive the elements that way together. As a courtesy to others who will be at the table, I invite you to use the hand sanitizer as you come this way and before sitting down. The song we've been singing all month is our prayer that prepares us to come here. At this table, everyone is welcome. At this table, everyone is seen. At this table, everybody matters. At this table, everything's forgiven, and there's enough for everyone. At this table, there's no judgment. At this table, mercy has a seat. At this table, we are all members of God's family. So come as you are. Have a seat. Spend a few minutes with Jesus.
At this table, everyone is welcome. Mind. At this table, this table, everybody cares. At this table, everybody matters. So come, pull up a chair.
Holy God, for the gift of your presence at this table, we are so grateful. For being with us here and out there in the world, in the hard moments and the easy, in the chaos of life and the quiet of our lonely moments, we give you thanks and praise. May our time here at the table with you and with each other grow us in spirit and confidence to live more fully as your people. And may we, when we are at tables with others in our lives, be your love, your grace, and your mercy for them. We pray this in the prayers of our hearts as we pray together the prayer you taught your followers, Jesus, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Like the ultimate comfort food, Jesus ministers to our weary hearts, our sad souls, and our distressed minds. Yes, we are especially mindful of his presence and the gifts that he offers when we come to the communion table. But what we've been discovering all month here is that any meal can be a place where Jesus shows up to melt away a frazzled day, to soothe an aching heart, or to connect us more deeply with someone in friendship. And because people found Jesus at the table, because that's where he engaged others with love and hope, because it was here that Jesus revealed who he was, this week, this Thursday, we'll be launching our own effort to create a table experience where we can set the table, invite people to join us, and expect Jesus will show up and something special will happen. So many of you have already volunteered to help make the table. That's what the Thursday night experience is called, Thursdays 6 p.m. here at the church, because so many of you have already offered to help make it an effective ministry, a place of welcome. We're ready to go this Thursday. Thank you all so much. Your presence, your ministry, and your service will be a blessing to everyone who comes and participates. Now, if you've not let me know that you want to help, please be in touch. That includes those who are worshiping with us online. If you're in the area, you want to be a part of Thursday night, we'd love to have you. Reach out and let me know you'd like to connect. Anyone here, just let me know, and I'll be glad to help you connect. There's also more information and sign-up sheets on a table in the great room on your way out. And please continue to hold this table ministry in prayer as we seek to share Jesus's table ministry with our friends and neighbors in the area. Also in February, as we seek to remain attentive to our own spiritual nourishment, Pastor Jacob will be leading a three-week online small group on the spiritual movements of loving God, loving self, and loving others, of growing upward, inward, and outward. Be in touch with myself or Pastor Jacob this week to get registered. Books and signups are out at the information wall just past the great room. You can find more information there. God is so very good to us. We never want to miss an opportunity to thank God, and so we gather like this. And we never want to miss an opportunity to pass those blessings on. If you'd like to bless God and others through your financial gifts, if you're here in person, there is a box on your way out to receive those gifts. If you're with us online or you just prefer online methods of managing your money, go to unionchapelindy.org. You'll find all the information you need there to give safely and securely online. Thank you. Thank you for being who you are. Thank you for being Jesus' people in the world. I invite you to experience this last song as we continue in our worship.
To eat.
somebody near you, your artwork, huh? Will you hold it up and show those around you? Beautiful. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Amen. Thank you for being a part of worship. It was really special, kids, to have you at the table with us this morning. I invite us all to be encouraged this week, maybe with a little comfort food, maybe not for every meal, but find a yummy morsel to enjoy this week that fills your belly. But be sure that as you feast with Jesus, every need will be met. Look for him to join you at whatever table you are at. As I look at our table this morning, broken bread, dripped juice, some things to clean up, I'm put in mind of when the week we talked about life with Jesus is a party. And there was a quote that one woman said, I always love to clean up a mess after a party because that means I've been with people I love. We've been with the people we love, each other and with Jesus. Go out to be his love in the world. Amen.